Previously on the Better Buildings Challenge Swap.
Look at this. This looks really old.
They're clearly not energy efficient.
They should be able to take advantage of having two sets of doors.
Just letting that cold air in.
Yeah. It looks like they missed some spots when they were installing the panels.
The city of Atlanta. The city of Boston. Hosted by Maria Vargas from the U.S. Department of Energy. Two energy teams swapped.
Mary, thank you so much for having us here in Atlanta.
Well, I can't tell you how happy we are to welcome you to the world's busiest passenger airport under the capable leadership of my friend Roosevelt Council. We're delighted to have you, Maria, and my friends from the Department of Energy. We're also delighted to welcome the Boston team and to take up Mayor Marty Walsh's challenge right here in the city of Atlanta. Mayor Walsh has sent his team down, and I've got my team, and we're ready to go. We're going to show the world why Atlanta is number one in the United States for the Better Buildings Challenge. Hopefully you guys can learn something. Let's go.
So having both Mayor Walsh and Mayor Reed be such strong advocates for energy efficiency and really sustainability and greater efforts in changing the way cities operate is a tremendous value.
Boston is fortunate that Massachusetts has a renewable portfolio standard, and they also have an energy efficiency standard. We don't have that at the state level, so we really have to work hard to create initiatives at the city level.
During Mayor Reed's administration, the concentration has been on the future of Atlanta, and energy efficiency is all about our capacity to provide services to the residents of the city cheaply, affordably, sustainably.
We've taken a leadership position in the Better Buildings Challenge, which is a very simple goal of reducing energy use by 20% by the year 2020. These are the right financial decisions to make, but they're also the right moral decisions to make for the direction and future of the city of Atlanta.
The Atlanta airport is the busiest, most traveled airport in the world. We have unique challenges because we operate 24/7, 365 days a year. We're over 6 million square feet.
The size of the building, sure, it's a little bit intimidating, but nothing that we can't handle. It's something that we're very, very used to.
It's a nice space.
Wow.
Wow, this is nice.
Very nice space.
Whoa, you get a little cold blast of air right there.
Yeah, you feel that draft?
Wow, yeah.
Okay.
I wonder if it's supposed to be putting cold air in here in December. And we just came from a really cold area, and now I'm feeling the heat in here.
You can feel the heat coming.
Which is kind of the opposite of where heat usually goes.
So it's got to be being pumped in from somewhere.
I think so. They might have some opportunities to move the heat around the building in a different way than they're doing it at the moment.
Good observation.
And wow.
Very hot here.
We're going to need to bring this one up here.
Huge temperature change walking into here.
Wow.
It looks like they're actually working on the
fixing this.
The AC and the ventilation. But
yeah, I would hope that they got to put a drop ceiling in here because this is all wasted heat up here right now.
The Atlanta team seemed like they were very, very confident that we weren't going to be able to find much, and you know, maybe a little overconfident. We walked through and found lots of little things that they could do better.
Check out these LEDs. We're the first airport in the country to have a completely LED airfield.
The world, actually.
What about the intensity on the lights? Are you able to adjust
you
those based on the weather?
You can change them based on the weather and the lighting conditions outside. It's really pretty cool.
Hey, Chief, how are you?
Hey,
Boston team, I want you to meet a native Atlantan, our wonderful Chief of the Fire Department, Chief Joel Baker.
Hey, Boston team, welcome to Atlanta.
Thank you.
Here at Hartsfield-Jackson, Atlanta International Airport, we have five fire stations that we're very engaged in sustainability initiative. Look around the fire station and see what you can do to help us improve.
We'll make sure to do that for you, Chief.
All right, hey, go take a look around. Have at it.
All right, let's go.
Okay. Let's keep our eyes on it.
Okay. All right. Well, you know, the Atlanta team mentioned that this building was built to be a LEED Silver standard,
right.
But even just walking here, you can see a couple opportunities where they might be able to improve. I mean, right above us, we see lighting that's not LED right off the bat. So that is certainly an opportunity for improvement. Looks like they've got some of their piping here insulated, so that's a good step as well. That's wonderful.
Yep. There's a thermostat over here.
Oh, what we got going on over here?
So room temp 74, and it's in heating mode. So here we go. So we've got thermostats on opposite sides of the room, and this one's actually in cooling mode at the moment. So we're doing some simultaneous heating and cooling.
Uh-oh.
That's an easy operational fix that we should point out to them.
Here's one of the living spaces. Oh, look, we have some phantom power going on, something plugged in and nothing charged
charging.
To it. So it's minor, but when it adds up, there'll be a good chance for them to get some energy. Same thing over here. So
yeah, it looks like a radio charger.
Right, with no radio. So
so a little behavioral stuff, you know.
Yeah.
Well, another one of those things that when you've got a big facility like the airport, some of these little things can fall through the cracks.
That's
but,
right.
Can add up to be a big impact. Okay.
Welcome to the Hemp Hill Water Treatment Plant. This is the heartbeat of our water system here in the city of Atlanta. We supply 65% of our service area, and I dare you to find anything in here.
All right, well, we're gonna find something, guarantee you.
The Department of Watershed Management has about 75 sites, and in total, we have over 100 buildings.
All right, well, let's see what we got here. First thing that you feel just immediately is it's cold
in
here.
It is very
cold in here. It's a pretty cold day. Not too many people are gonna be in here at any given time, but you see that they've got some of these heaters that are going. Look at how high up it's located. Even when I put my hand up like this, I'm not feeling any of the heat.
So you can definitely feel the air, but it's really only coming right across the top of my head, so really simple adjustment.
This is clearly where they use the vast majority of their energy, pumping water. They've got, it looks like, over half a dozen major pumps here. That's where they really have to make sure that they're being energy efficient.
Exactly.
And we can ask them a little bit more about that later, see what type of upgrades that they've made with that or what they've got planned for their capital improvements.
All right, so these are all the controllers for those pumps. Let's see what we got here. Yeah, so this panel's reading about 155 amps, and I believe this is over 400 volts, so you're talking well over 70 kilowatts per pump.
Wow.
So as much as they might be doing with, efficiency within their, building envelope, their lighting, these pumps are gonna outweigh a lot of that.
Right.
So like you said, the efficiency is gonna help.
It looks like right behind you, though, we've got one of their variable frequency drives, or VFDs here. So at least they have that balance. From what I understand, they've got four of their pumps on constant, four on VFD.
Okay.
So instead of switching them on and creating too much pressure, they're able to modulate a little bit with some of those VFDs.
Right.
The Hemp Hill Water Treatment Complex is a really interesting space to walk around as well. As much as we pointed out minor energy efficiency opportunities through lighting, through HVAC, like you'd find in a traditional building, the vast majority of their power is going to industrial processes like the pumping we saw over at the pump stations. There are minor gains to be made in terms of efficiency here, but it's really those large capital improvement projects that are going to drive efficiency.
Yeah, having been in Boston and looking at how they were using light and the variations in temperature, and then to come back here and be in the airport and look at the same things was very revealing to me. You could see it everywhere. The things that we were critiquing, I got a little embarrassed now once we got to the airport and we saw such similar things.
We really need to go after the big bangs, the big bucks. So you want to make sure that you're going after what's going to actually help your cities.
You don't need to be in New England or in a state that's very friendly towards energy efficiency to drive the market. And I think learning from examples like Atlanta can help expand through different states that have similar regulatory frameworks.
Coming up in the next episode, the City of Boston and City of Atlanta both showed off the great work they are doing in energy efficiency, but also bring to the table a new perspective to save even more energy. See what they recommend to one another on episode 3.